Hello and welcome to the next generation of network games, a video series. Here you will learn how to design and create your own network games of the future using Unreal Engine and Spatial OS. In this video, we will examine network games as a medium and the state of the current generation.
So I'm going to have to start learning today, here, now. Come, dragon, I will fight you. Sancho Panza, my sword.
Chris Crawford, the founder of GDC, often called the Socrates of games. In his dragon speech, he tells the story of the basic idea behind games. He sees game ideas as dreams, vague, blurry images consisting only of the outlines, and these ideas are represented in metaphors like dreams of a dragon. He considers games to be a unique medium because of their interactivity. They can fundamentally change the ways we communicate en masse. Instead of being a static observer who listens, as in classical media, games allow us to interact. Crawford calls for a set of technologies that can help interactivity. These boil down to the simulation of human behavior through AI and visual audio parity with the real world. Since the simulation of human behavior, in a fully dynamic sense where a simulated human can react to any possible situation, is extremely difficult, if not impossible, to execute, we cannot rely on it as a basis for a truly interactive medium. The only obvious solution to this problem is to network people so that they can interact together. This is the basic idea behind networking games, so this video series is focused on the same.
Biggest threat, however, are the survivors. Friendlies are few, and strangers are more likely to turn you into human steak.
Crawford invokes that a game is a communication between its creators and the player. This concept in network games translates to the creator setting up an environment in which players will communicate with each other. That is, the creator sets the rules of the world while the players interact in it. The limit on the number of possible interactions changes from the limitation of a set algorithm to a practically unlimited number of ideas of a human being. One of the most important factors in any game is the number of interactions, as Adam Millard put it in his video, Putting Players Back in Multiplayer. Let's get back to Crawford's set of technologies. We will consider visual and auditory parity with the real world through the principle of realism, as precision, detail, or fidelity of a simulation. Players are accustomed to the real world and expect the game to behave like it. To conclude, interaction and a simulation's fidelity play an important role in network games. It logically follows that the environment with more players has more interaction, and it is therefore important that the number of players in a network game is expanded to the technological bleeding edge. Let's now examine the current generation of network games and their technical limitations. Fortnite, made in Unreal Engine 4, contains 100 players with 40 to 50,000 replicated actors, that is, interactive elements. These interactive elements are destructive objects like trees and walls, pickup weapons, artificial intelligence, and the like. The world is refreshed very quickly, i.e. the server sends updates to the clients 30 times in a second or at 30 Hz, while the client sends its data to the server at 60 Hz. Refreshing can be variable, so at the beginning of the round where all 100 players are in one place, the refresh rate is dynamically reduced to 10 Hz. This results in an average rate of 45 kilobits per second for download and 42 kilobits per second for upload, which is more than acceptable for a wired connection. The only flaw with this game is the lack of physical objects. These are just vehicles and objects that can be picked up, which gives an impression of a somewhat static world. Fortnite is the standard of the current generation, so 100 players in an interactive world with a high refresh rate. Battlefield 4 is one of the most advanced games in the field of networking technology. It consists of 64 players in a very dynamic world with a destructible environment, deformable terrain, physics-based vehicles, and projectiles. It also uses an advanced technique called high-frequency network spheres, which is an advanced distance-based replication technique. It takes into account the proximity of other characters, so that closer characters refresh faster if they're in a certain distance, and the field of view of the client, so that those players inside the FOV get refreshed the fastest. These fields are created on the basis of three classes, pedestrian, ground vehicle, and air vehicle, due to their different speeds and fields of view. This method has enabled scaling of the networking system to 120 Hz, which keeps pace with competitive games like Counter-Strike Global Offensive. You can check out Chris's Battle Nonsense video on how it works after this video. The only drawbacks of this game are the number of players, which does not follow the current trends of 100 plus players. Furthermore, its destruction is non-dynamic. The environment can be destroyed in only one way, and it has a lack of AI. This game has one of the best networking configurations and will serve as a good technical goal for this paper.
Imagine waking up in the dirt, only to discover you are right in the middle of the post-apocalypse. Well, that just became your reality.
DayZ Standalone is a game that through its development serves as a perfect argument for server authoritative logic. It started life as a modification of the game Arma 2, and later switched to a standalone version in the Real Virtuality engine. DayZ as a game is very punishing. It is played in a persistent world, and if the player ever dies, he starts from the beginning, losing all progress. It motivates individuals to look for ways to cheat, and since Real Virtuality as an environment was very client-oriented, it was very easy. When we say client-oriented, we mean that the user was trusted when he said something to the server. He could tell the server he was on one end of the world and the next moment at a completely different end, or that he never received damage, that he had countless bullets, and so on. For these and many other reasons, the server authoritative model had to be implemented through the development of the Infusion engine, where, through a long campaign of re-engineering the engine itself, they eliminated most of the methods of cheating. Today, in 2021, DayZ is a very impressive network game, with hundreds of thousands of networked objects, vehicles, a lot of players, and a lot of AI. The conclusion we can draw from DayZ is that we need to create games from the ground up with networking in mind, and with the server-side authoritative model. Planetside 2 is a slightly older game, but it has a configuration concentrated on maximizing the number of players. It is a set of connected servers into a single experience. One server in this connected set is called a shard. One of these shards can host up to 2,000 players. This represents the upper limit of the current generation and single server architectures. It should be mentioned that it sacrifices fidelity to achieve these numbers, like not replicating projectiles to players, etc.
This planet is rich in vegetation, but there's a lot more here than trees.
Obviously, network games are very technically demanding. They are limited mostly due to processor performance and the current single server architecture, and are designed around these constraints. They are often just repurposed from local games to networked ones, without too much thought given to the consequences. The result is a very sparse simulation that only gives the appearance of realism and provides a limited number of interactions. Which brings us to the idea of the next generation of games. We want to completely separate ourselves from the limitations of the single server architecture. We want more players in a bigger, more detailed, and more persistent world. In short, we want games with less compromise to computing limitations. As a specification for the next generation of games in a network sense, we will use the average global internet speed, which we estimate at 100 megabits per second. From the server side, we assume a 10 gigabit per second connection. Furthermore, the game must be server authoritative to eliminate the possibility of cheating. It must exceed the current generation in player numbers and fidelity. We will achieve this through a change in architecture, and as an extension of that, we will work on networked physics as well as other networked features. Lastly, we will provide the rules of the game for as much interaction as possible through game and match functionality. Come back next week for a networked physics overview where we will examine deterministic lockstep and state sync.